Hello everyone, once again welcome you all in the online lecture series. From last few days we are talking about a chapter that is colorimetry. Colorimetry is the technique where interaction of electromagnetic radiation with matter, and when there is light will be absorbed by the matter. And if we measure the absorbed radiation, that is called as a absorption spectroscopy. And in this topic we are mainly concerned with a ultraviolet as well as visible spectroscopy, because when the ultraviolet and visible light will be interact with matter, then the valence electron which is present in the outer shell of the atom or the electrons which are present on the molecule, that will be goes to excited state. And if we measure such absorbed radiation, that gives a basis of colorimetry. In this technique we are mainly concerned with two fundamental laws, that is Lambert's law and Beer's law. Lambert's law is related to the path length of the sample cell, and Beer's law is related to the concentration of the medium. And if we see a combined law for Lambert's Beer's law, it is also called as a Beer's law, then absorption is directly proportional to the path length and its concentration. In last lecture we discussed some problem on the basis of this Lambert's Beer's law, and the if we know the absorbance, how to calculate transmittance, and if we know the transmittance, how to calculate the absorbance of the solution. That we have discussed in previous lecture. Now in this technique we will be discuss a instrumentation pattern,
colorimetry.
If we see the block diagram of this instrumentation, or how the instrumentation is arranged in the spectrophotometric technique and its component, that will be shown by a block diagram. First one is called as a radiant source, that is the light which is fall on the sample, that gives absorption spectroscopy, and for that we require a radiation source. It is called as a radiant source. Then this radiant source will be emit some light, so that will be traveling through the space, and then it will be enters into the filters or monochromator. Because the radiation source containing a polychromatic light, and that will be converted into a monochromatic light, and for that we require filters or monochromators. Then this light will be travel through a sample solution or the solvent, where the actual absorption will be takes place, right? The radiation source will be travel through filters or monochromators, where the polychromatic light is converted into monochromatic light, and this monochromatic light will be enters into the solvent or sample solution, and then it will be goes to a detector. Detector will be detect how much light will be absorbed by the sample, how much light is transmitted by the sample. That can be measured the detector, and then finally it will be goes to the readout system. Readout system will be gives the signal in terms of a chart, or sometimes it can be used a digital signals, so that can use how much of light will be absorbed, how much light will be transmitted by the sample solution. So this is the block diagram of the spectrophotometer, generally which is used in the spectrophotometer. For that mainly five basic components are there, it is radiant source, filters or monochromators, solvent or solution, it is a compartment or sample cell where the solvent or solution will be taken, then detector, and finally readout system. So let us discuss each part in detail. Before that we will see the cross sectional view of the spectrophotometer. So this is a instrument which is used called as a spectrophotometer. And in the spectrophotometer, these components are used. And how these are used? So first one is called as a power supply. So power supply is required to use the radiation source, and that will be used to the sources. So in the sources, there are lamps are used. That is called as a radiation source. It may be different types of lamps. That is tungsten filament lamp or deuterium lamp. Sometimes other lamps can be used. Then from the source, the light is emitted. The emitted light are in terms of a polychromatic light, and these polychromatic light will be entrance into the monochromator, where the filters or sometimes monochromators can be used, where we can choose a wavelength. That means we can use a wavelength which is desired for the absorption. Then it will be enters into the slit assembly. Slit assembly will be make the beam parallel, or it can be a narrow beam will be provided by the slit assembly. And then it will be goes to the sample compartment. Sample compartment is there, that is the sample holder is there, which can be hold the sample of solvent. And finally it goes to detector. Detector will be gives a response, how much of light will be absorbed. Here is detector is placed, and finally it will be shown by here, or sometimes it is connected to the computer so that we can measure the absorbed radiation or transmitted radiation. So this is the cross sectional view of a spectrophotometer. Let us discuss each part in detail, that is the basic components which are used in the spectrophotometry are radiation source, filters or monochromators, then sample holder, detector and the readout system, among which first one is called as a radiation source. Radiation source is nothing but it is the device which can be gives a light which is required for the analysis of the sample. So that means generally in spectrophotometer we require a ultraviolet as well as visible light, that is from 200 to 800 nanometer. But the ultraviolet region is nothing but 200 to 400 nanometer, and visible is 400 to 800 nanometer. So among these, in the visible region, a tungsten filament lamp is mostly used. That means if we want to choose a visible region, and for that visible region a tungsten filament lamp which can be provides light in the range 400 to 800 nanometer, and that is most probably used. The construction of this tungsten filament lamp is very similar to the household lamp, same like household lamp which is used in the house. So its construction is same like this. Then it consists of a piece of tungsten wire which is heated in a controlled atmosphere. That means there is a evacuated glass bulb, and into that glass bulb there are two rods, and these two rods are connected by means of tungsten wire, and where the tungsten wire is heated, and then it will provide the light in the visible region, right? Then to avoid the fluctuation in the reading, it is necessary that the tungsten lamp should be provide a constant radiation energy. That means whatever power supply is provided to the tungsten filament lamp, that must be constant so that the fluctuation in the reading will not be observed, and therefore this can be achieved by employing a constant power supply to the lamp, right? So that means we have to apply the constant power supply so that the fluctuation in will be not observed, and it can be used a continuous radiation by the tungsten filament lamp. Though the construction of this tungsten filament lamp is simple and production cost is low, so it having some drawbacks, right? So when we know that the tungsten filament lamp is very simple, its construction is also simple, and cost is also very low, but this having one important major drawback, that means it can provide a radiate energy near the infrared region. That means most of the radiation provided by the tungsten filament lamp is near the infrared region, but in this technique or in the spectrophotometry we require the radiation energy in visible region, that is 200 to 400 nanometer, 400 to 800 nanometer, but the tungsten filament lamp will be provide the radiation in the near infrared region. Suppose we see one example, that means when we are heating the tungsten filament lamp near about 1725 degrees Celsius, so it gives only 1% radiation in the visible region, right? That means at 1725 degrees Celsius, it provides only 1% radiation in the visible region, and most of the 99% radiation in the near IR region. But if we increase the temperature from 1725 to 2725 degrees Celsius, it gives 15% radiation in the visible region, right? But it is observed that as the operating temperature increases, the life of the lamp will be decreases. That means if the temperature increases, it can be provide more and more light in the visible region, but as the temperature increases, the life of the lamp will be decreased. So this is the actual image of the tungsten filament lamp, which is very similar to household lamp. That means there is a glass bulb, and into the glass bulb there is a tungsten wire is heated, and that tungsten wire when heated, it provides radiation in the visible as well as near IR region, right? So here is a graphical representation which can shows the operating temperature and the light which is emitted by the tungsten filament lamp in the region, that is in UV visible and IR region, and also the energy provided by the radiation source of the tungsten filament lamp. That means at 1725 degree, the curve which shows curve 1 is for 1725, it is observed that it gives more radiation in the IR region, but as the temperature increases from 1725 to 2725, the graph is increases from 1 to 2 and more radiation will be observed in the visible region. And for the fourth, that is 3725 degrees Celsius, it gives more intense light as well as it gives more light in the UV as well as visible region. Right? So this is the graphical show. But at higher temperature, the life of the lamp is reduced. That is already say that. That means at the higher temperature, the life of the lamp is reduced. And thus it is desirable to use a moderate operating temperature in such a way that it gives most of the light in the visible region and the life of the lamp is also increased. Right? The use of absorbing filter between the lamp and sample which absorb most of the infrared radiation. That means if we use a moderate temperature and if we want the, radiation in the visible region, then we can use a absorption filter so that the all other radiations which are present in the near IR region will be absorbed and only it transmit the light which is present in the visible region. The tungsten filament lamp may be replaced by the carbon arc lamp. Sometimes we can use the carbon arc lamp instead of tungsten filament lamp, which gives more intense source of visible light is required. Because the carbon arc lamp, that means it gives in form of arc, that means the arc, carbon arc is fed into the two rods into the acrylic glass bulb, and when it is heated, it gives more and more light in the visible region and also it gives more intense light. In ultraviolet spectroscopy or in ultraviolet spectrophotometer, hydrogen lamp or deuterium lamp, sometimes xenon discharge lamp or mercury arc lamps are used as a radiation source. Because the tungsten filament lamp and carbon arc lamp gives only light in visible as well as near IR region, but if we want the radiation into the ultraviolet region, we can use either hydrogen lamp or deuterium lamp or the xenon discharge lamp or sometimes a mercury arc lamp can be used in the radiation source for the ultraviolet spectrophotometer. In a hydrogen discharge lamp, hydrogen gas is stored under relatively high pressure, right? And due to that, when we use electric discharge is passed through the lamp, then electrons will be collide against the hydrogen molecule and hydrogen molecule will be goes to excitation state and it again comes to ground state by emission of some light, and that emitted light will be in the ultraviolet region, right? So this is called as a hydrogen discharge lamp. Or this collision results in the formation of excited hydrogen molecules which are emits UV radiation. That means when the hydrogen gas is fed into the moderate pressure into the eucalyptic glass bulb, and if we use two rods and if we apply the power supply, then the electrons will be travel from one electrode to another electrode, and these electrons will be collides on the hydrogen molecule, and this collision will be makes the hydrogen excitation, and the excited hydrogen molecule again comes to ground state by emission of some light in the UV radiation. So this hydrogen lamp cover the range of 120 to 530 nanometer. That means most of the ultraviolet region covered by this hydrogen lamp, and these lamps are stable and widely used. So these are mostly used in ultraviolet spectroscopy. In deuterium lamp, deuterium is used in place of hydrogen gas. So only a difference is that in deuterium lamp, instead of hydrogen, we can use a deuterium gas in the eucalyptic glass bulb, and the same phenomenon will be observed when the electrons will be collided on the deuterium molecule, and it will be shows excitation, and due to that excitation, it will be emits radiation in the ultraviolet region. But the intensity of this deuterium lamp is 3 to 5 times more as compared to the hydrogen lamp. Okay? So, if you see the intensity between hydrogen lamp and deuterium lamp, the intensity is more about 3 to 5 times as compared to the hydrogen lamp, and therefore, in spectrophotometer, we are use a mainly deuterium lamp for the ultraviolet radiation. So these lamps are more expensive than a hydrogen lamp, but are used when high intensity is required. So this deuterium lamp having a high cost, or we can say it is more expensive as compared to the hydrogen lamp, but it can be used for the ultraviolet spectroscopy when there is a high intensity light is required. In xenon discharge lamp, xenon gas is stored under high pressure, and here again same thing is happen. That means the collision of electrons on the xenon gas will give excitation, and due to the excitation it gives a light in the ultraviolet region. So it possesses two tungsten electrodes separated by 8 mm distance. That means in eucratic glass bulb, the xenon gas is stored under a high pressure, and there are two tungsten electrodes which are separated by 8 mm distance, and then it provides a, you can say, power supply, and due to that power supply the collision of electrons will be takes place. An intense arc is formed between two tungsten electrodes by applying a low voltage, and this will be results in the production of ultraviolet radiation. So this is a construction as well as working of this xenon discharge lamp. In mercury arc lamp, mercury vapor is stored under a high pressure. When an electric discharge is passed through it, excited mercury atoms will be produced and which emits the radiation in the ultraviolet region. So that means in hydrogen lamp, deuterium lamp, xenon discharge lamp and mercury arc lamp, the vapors of this gas are stored into the eucratic glass bulb, and the if we apply the power supply to the electrode, then the collision of electrons will be takes place, and due to that the gas will be goes to excitation state, and it again comes to ground state by emission of some light, and these light will be emits in the ultraviolet region. So this is called as a hydrogen discharge lamp, or we can say deuterium lamp, xenon discharge lamp, mercury arc lamp. So in general, the radiation source must be fulfill some requirements. When we are using the radiation source in the ultraviolet as well as visible spectroscopy or in spectrophotometer, so these must having some requirements, and these requirements are nothing but it must be stable. So if we want a continuous spectrum of light, or if we want a correct absorption of light, then the radiation source must be stable so that it can be used a continuous spectrum. Then it must be produces sufficient intensity of radiation so that the transmitted intensity can be detected at the end of optical path, right? The intensity must be in sufficient so that the detector can be shows a response. That means the radiation source must have in sufficient intensity so that the transmitted intensity can be easily detected. And the third one, it must supply a continuous spectrum of radiation over the entire wavelength in which it is used. So these are the some basic requirements when we are using radiation source in the ultraviolet as well as visible spectrophotometer, or we can say spectrophotometer. Then the next is called as a control of radiant power. So in between radiation source and the monochromators and filter, there is a control of radiant power. That means if you want to control the radiant power, there are required a intense and narrow beam of radiation in colorimetric and spectrophotometric analysis. We require a intense as well as a narrow beam so that it can be traveled through the sample solution, and it must have a sufficient intensity so that detector will be shows response. And for this purpose, the control of radiant power contains the mirrors as well as lenses and slits. That is mirrors, lenses and slits. So there are two types of mirrors are used. It is called as a concave mirror. So this mirror can be used to deflect the light in the desired direction and to extend the path length of the beam inside the instrument. So that means before the radiation source, suppose this is radiation source, so this before the radiation source there is a concave mirror is used, and so this mirror will be deflect the radiation in the direction of the sample is placed, right? So that means more and more radiation would be fed into the sample container so that it can use a more intense light, and this can be fed to the instrument. Then the lenses can be employed to get a intense and parallel beam of light. So there is a collimating lens. You know that the radiation will be traveling in all direction, but if you want to radiation into one direction, then for that we are using a collimating lens, and these collimating lens make the beam parallel. And there are two slits are used. One is called as a entrance slit and second one is called as a exit slit. So this entrance slit is placed before the monochromator, and the exit slit is placed after the monochromator. Sometimes it is placed after the sample holder, right? So there are two types of slit, and this slit is adjusted in a such way that it can make a beam in a we can say as narrow as possible, right? Then the window width of the slit can be changed as per the requirement. So this slits having a width, and that can be required as per the requirement. And these slits control the amount of incoming and outgoing light. Incoming light, that is which is coming from the radiation source, and outgoing, that is transmitted through the monochromators or the sample holder, and therefore it can be controlled, right? The use of these devices gives a following advantage. When we are using the control of radiation power, then this having some advantage. That means it obeys a Beer's law. Beer's law, that is absorption directly proportional to the concentration, and therefore if we want to obey the Beer's law, then radiation source must be in such that it can be used a continuous spectrum, and for that we require more intense light and a narrow beam so that a Beer's law is obeyed. Then interference of stray light is avoided. Sometimes a stray light will be there, and that can be avoided if we adjust the slit, and the sensitivity of measurement can be increased. If the more intense light are there, and due to that more intense light, the sensitivity of the measurement is increased, because the sensitivity is depending on the intensity of light and detector response, right? So this is all about a basic component which are used in the instrumentation of spectrophotometer and the radiation source. The remaining part we'll be discussing next lecture. So thank you for watching video. Thank you.